Recorded Books presents A Small Silence by Jumoke Verissimo, narrated by Akin. Four Olodumare and four oracles who in their prime revealed the riddles of the dark. Femi Awote, Felix Okadigbo, Oluwatosin Bokno, Pius Adesomi. Darkness is your candle. Your boundaries are your quest. Wetness and water in the Big Red Book. Jalal al-Din Rumi. Chapter 1. Prof turned off all the lights in the house when he returned from prison. He bathed, cleaned, ate, and slept in the darkness which devoured the whole flat. When he did not have any cleaning or cooking to do, he would sit in his chair reciting passages from books he had memorized. He cooked his meals on an old kerosene stove whose red and yellow flames leapt out of the world burner and lapped the sides of the steel pot. The light from the fire made him wince and mutter, "Ish, ish, ish." His house was not always dark as soot, because the worn light of an electric bulb drifted in at night through the only window in the sitting room and sat on the arm of the chair opposite his. It irritated him. In the daytime, the heavy curtains his mother had hung covered the room in a thick shade, but could not prevent the sun's intrusion. The slight parting in the curtains allowed a thin stroke of light to fall on the floor of the sitting room. Prof tried, though, to keep in the darkness. He adjusted the curtains, but they always fell apart, inviting shadows to lay claim to new spaces in the room. It was dark, but never dark enough. Prof soon grew tired of aligning the curtains. He turned his attention to staring at the shadows which formed beside the furniture, moving around the house like a blind man born to his handicap, sensing when something was not in its rightful place. He regained confidence in knowing that the flat was as familiar with him as he was with it. He crept in and out of rooms, floating like a paper lifted by the wind. Sometimes, he strayed into a room where he grazed an object, took note of the positioning, and counted his steps backward and forward to avoid hitting the same object twice. As he moved from one room to another, filling spaces, he dreamt of dreadful ways in which his enemies, those who made him go to prison, would die. On the nights that his irritation filled the room, he defied his fear of the electric bulbs on the streets and took a long stroll around Jakonde Estate. It was at these times that he bought kerosene or some foodstuff that he needed. Carrying an empty 4-litre jerrycan, he would brace himself with his praise names before leaving the house, with a walking stick made from a rusty iron rod which had once served as a curtain bar. He walked out onto the street, covered from head to toe like a woman in a burqa, his ears catching distinct conversations in the mix of clamoring voices, car honks, and sometimes bleating goats finding their way home, alongside the music that blared from roadside CD-DVD kiosks. Prof stopped by one of the kiosks, defaced with campaign posters for the just-concluded election, which had seen President Obasanjo elected for a second term. The poster that caught his attention was torn, and what was left of it was the lean face of Muhammadu Buhari, the name of Chuba Okadigbo, his ANPP running mate, and the words, "We will not do, it's a promise." Prof wondered what the lost words could be. After 10 years of absence, this was what he had returned to. Two former military heads of state contesting for president. He tried to dismiss the thought of Nigeria's politics from his mind, but he could not. Ah, Obasanjo of the 70s contesting against Buhari of the 80s, and this is 2005? He blurted out. How can this country move forward when it seeks the dead to bring revival? People stared at him, but turned away before their eyes met. It was often this way. People hurried ahead or crossed to the other side of the road once he turned to look at them. He was more interested in those who walked ahead of him in a pair or in threesomes, sharing neighborhood gossip or intimate stories. It was through them that he discovered his neighborhood was the black cauldron that cooked rumors for several other blocks of flats, lit with bright fluorescent lamps to savor. Prof overheard one such rumour of himself and his flat on one of his infrequent night strolls. As he walked away from his home that day, he listened to two straw-thin teenage girls selling plantain chips tell the story of his life as they must have heard it.
That is the home of the man I was telling you about, the bastard one that came back mad.
Is it that professor that Uncle was talking about yesterday?
Yes. His father was a landlord here before he died.
Does that man even come out?
Out, Ke. That is trouble for us in this neighborhood. If you go to his doorstep, you're as good as dead. Uncle said that if he kills, nothing will happen, as he's a madman. He'll be free of guilt.
How does he live inside that place without coming out for lights?
Uncle said he has iron bars on his doors and windows.
How does Uncle know, Seth? What does he eat?
I think he'll only eat cockroaches and rats.
The girls took furtive glances at Prof's building, and when one tried to point towards it, the other one hit her on the shoulder to drop her hand.
Stop it! Don't point!
What will happen if I do?
Nothing. Just don't point at that madman's house. He could even be dead. Until his dead body begins to smell and council comes here, we can't even go near that place.
Prof walked behind them. He listened with a little smile sneaking onto the corners of his mouth, till it gave way to a small chuckle as the girls hurried away. It was at that moment that Desonya came to stand beside him. She often joined him on his excursions, and they would stand in front of the building to compare his flat to the others. His flat was noticeable, the way one notices a missing incisor tooth on a young woman. Prof observed the way the darkness of the flat established itself before the world around it. At these times, he would tell Desonya of how bothered he was that the little brightness encroached on the darkness of the area. Sometimes, he told her of how, while standing outside, he considered what would become of him if light flooded the rooms. But once he stepped into the flat, the darkness in the room enveloped him, and he settled into it to brood over his past. Desonya left him at these times, evanescing from his thoughts the same way she came. Chapter 2. Desire sprawled on the bed with her arms and legs asunder. The only piece of cloth on her was her panties, but she could still feel the heat. Her phone beeped, and she read the text message Remy Lekun forwarded to her from the landlord with a smile. He was asking for the month's rent again. She and Remy Lekun always replied to his messages with, "How much is it again?" They both knew he couldn't reply because Mama T, Remy Lekun's mother, paid the rent automatically from her bank account. Yet the landlord would always send a text on the 28th of every month requesting the month's rent. As Desire turned on the bed, her thoughts moved to the irony of the insomnia and discomfort she felt on a mattress with coil springs, compared to the way she had slept like a log on a cardboard or mat on the beach where she spent her childhood. What does it mean to be comfortable? Desire thought. There had been a time when she yearned for a bed, and now that she had one, she wanted the breeze-cooled beach of her childhood days. Desire didn't like living in Abesson. She hadn't wanted to live in Abesson Estate, but because Remy Lekun was infatuated with a young man at the time, whose face was shaped like a camel's, she succumbed to her friend's choice. The next step had been to convince Remy Lekun's mother of their preferred residence. She could still hear Remy Lekun pleading as she made a sorry face.
"Tell my mom that living in Abesson is better now. You know, because of cultists."
Desire had looked into Remy Lekun's eyes and sniggered.
"Stop it, I'm serious. Tell her cultist activities on campus is too much around Iba or even Ojo, and those places are the closest areas to the university, but
you want to go and collect strokes from Mr. Longface."
"What strokes? Is he a teacher?"
"I hear you, whatever you people call it. You want to be close to Mr. Longface's thing. Please. And please stop calling him Mr. Longface. He has like, I don't even know.
Seriously, have you seen his eyes? They just enter your body. Like they practically leave his eye sockets and move into your body.
Remy Lekun, all of this for a man who does not even notice you.
You want us to go and live in that place that is almost 1 hour from campus, even without traffic? We will have time for ourselves.
Then, realizing that something sounded odd about what she had said, she rephrased it.
We'll have time to do whatever we want. You can even bring your boyfriend. I would never talk. I'll even leave the room for both of you.
I beg. This is you asking me to do that for you when it happens. So when the time and choice of accommodation came, Desire did not find it difficult convincing Mama T with stories of student cultists in uniform chasing professors from classrooms, tales of rape and limbs staring at you first thing in the morning by the gate. She embellished her stories as much as she could from newspaper reports that carried vivid photographs, mangled bodies found in front of campuses, students running from their classes as cult factions fought openly on campuses with guns and knives. It was easy narrating the horror stories to Mama T. The university was close to a transit center managed by Agbirus, who called themselves Area Boys, because it showed that beyond being ruffians, they had a claim to the money they extorted from the buses passing through the area. Inevitably, fights broke out because of power struggles between different factions. Because the university campus was close to the Agbirus territory, there was usually no distinction between the ruffians' fights and students' protests. After a while, the regular occurrence of this led to some of the students coming up with even more horror stories to emphasize that their university was more gangster-like. It was a badge of honor to be in a university where you could always act like the hero in an action film. Mama T was so concerned by the violence that she asked Remy Lekun to forget university and join her in her wholesale business.
"Or you people can go to university from my house, Abi," Mama T suggested.
Mama T's Yoruba, and even Pidgin or English, when she spoke, carried a zest because of her inability to pronounce the letter R. Yoruba words like rara, ronti, or enro carried an urban corruption of Yoruba which added a W where the R should be.
"How would we cope with reading with all these visitors who come to see you at home?"
"The distance, Nko. Have you regarded the distance from the house to the campus?" retorted Remy Lekun.
"It is a direct bus. Just one bus. Ojo is not foul. Iba too.
Mama T, the cults are always fighting in those places." With the mention of cults, Mama T sighed.
"Ah, God Ukuku protect you from all those children bringing their afflicted head from home to the campus.
Amio, and we don't even have lectures every day, so we can stay home and read. It is convenient for us," Desire lied.
"But there's never light there, Abi. Don't you know that Ikwaja area never has power? At least you need to be comfortable where you are weeding."
"Is there light in Surulere here? Is there light anywhere in this country? Are we not all living in darkness?"
Remy Lekun said with a laughter that caught on. Mama T shook her head.
"Me, I'm going to the market. Just try to find a good place in Abesson, okay?"
Once Mama T agreed, they went searching. Their story of living in Abesson, however, began with the landlord telling them that the previous tenant had left without paying his electricity bill of 3 years, and so there was no power in their room.
"I will just tap light from the pastor's room next door."
"How now? You're connecting us illegally after we paid for electricity?"
Remy Lekun snapped at him.
"How now, Bawo? Don't you want light? Or what kind of question is this?"
The landlord had already climbed a chair and was twisting wires in the ceiling before they could protest. Remy Lekun had almost fallen over laughing at the sight.
"You people don't know that we just have to make things work somehow in this country. We don't have a government. We find ways to do things somehow.
It did not matter whether they wanted electricity or not, because 3 weeks went by and the entire area was in total darkness. The estate's transformer was carted away for repairs, and no one knew when it would be returned by the power authority. The landlord never came to see them either after they moved into the house. He only sent reminder messages.
"It is month end. God provide. Pay up. Stay blessed."
Desire dismissed the landlord's text from her mind and, turning on the bed, closed her eyes. When she next opened them, night had fallen. She looked at the clock and saw it was just a few minutes from 3 in the morning. The sound of footsteps drew close to the door, signaling Remy Lekum's return.
Remilekun staggered into the room, although no smell of alcohol drifted in with her. Desire remained still on the bed, heaving slowly like she was fast asleep, while listening to her friend's movements as she took off her clothes, which would most likely join the heap on the floor. As expected, she felt hot air against the side of her face, indicating that Remilekun was hovering over her. Remilekun, as usual, was not deterred by the fact that Desire seemed to be asleep. She jumped onto Desire's bed, screaming and laughing, while tickling her to ensure that Desire stayed awake to listen to her. "Oh yeah, wake up, let us talk." "Stop tickling me," Desire feigned a sleep-induced voice to calm the laughter thundering out of Remilekun's mouth as if it needed to settle into Desire and fill her up with gaiety. "Remilekun, it is past 3 in the morning." "So? I can't miss my friend again. I mean, you've not seen me for 3 good days." "I beg, let me sleep." Desire turned to the wall. "You better turn and face me, or I won't give you the real gist." Desire remained quiet, facing the wall. "Eh? I have to tell you something." Desire ignored her, even when she tapped her shoulder. "See, I'm serious, oh. It's about that man you're always talking about, the professor guy." Desire turned to face her, sitting up on the bed. She held herself still, nerves pulled tight like dried cowhide. "Prof, what about him?" "Yes, the prof guy. He's out of prison," Remilekun said, flinging a newspaper at Desire's chest. Desire focused on the pages of the newspaper, flipping slowly despite her racing heart, until she got to the page with Prof's story. She raised her head and was going to ask if she could keep the newspaper, but Remilekun was off again. "Do you remember Tox, that guy with the cute rabbit teeth? I saw him yesterday at the party."
"Mm-hmm."
Desire nodded so Remilekun would just get to the point. She, however, noted that her infatuation and the major reason she made them move to Abesson Estate was no longer Mr. Longface, but now the one with the teeth like rabbit, and Remilekun seemed eager to talk about it.
"We talked a lot. I didn't even know he was so much fun to talk to."
On another occasion, Desire might have poked fun at the rabbit teeth and what was cute about them, but this time she was eager to hear about Prof.
"Mm-hmm,"
she grunted. "He has his own clothing line, and he said he's traveling to London this summer to see about a new business he's thinking about."
"Mm-hmm."
Remilekun realized she was losing her audience, so she returned to Prof's story. "Tox gave me the newspaper. The party was at his father's house in VI.
From what Tox told me, people are saying the professor is not normal again, oh.
They say he lives on cockroaches and insects. He only goes out at night and things like that. A lot of this and that, like they've heard screams inside the house. Maybe he eats people that go to his doorstep or something."
"I don't believe that one, Sha. You really shouldn't believe anyone would be capable of eating someone in a community like this. Not in this 21st century. How did your friend know?"
"He's a big boy now. Everybody knows he's a rich boy who is living in this area for whatever reason. People will want him to drop something. So to get money from him, they'll feed him stories about the area, even when he doesn't want to hear them."
"I hear you.
My sister, leave that matter, I beg. What is there not to believe?
Was Clifford Orji not a man? He was killing and roasting people in broad daylight at a place where people commuted, and he wasn't found out or arrested for several years. Where is he today? Prison or madhouse? Didn't they tell us Clifford was a madman, ignorant of his actions? Madness. It's the reason the world has gone under. And let me just tell you something. There is no one who would go to a Nigerian prison for more than 6 months and come back sane. That man, according to the newspaper, was there for 10 years. Have you been to the police stations? Now imagine what the maximum prisons are like. I beg, hell is closer than we think."
They both laughed, and Remilekun added, "Even the average policeman behind the counter looks like a prisoner dressed up for interrogation. I beg." Desire laughed out loud. It was again one of those few times that Remilekun talked politics. Remilekun's jokes didn't anger her. Instead, they helped lighten the anxiety that followed her realization that Prof was close by. Now, with the knowledge that he was living in the same vicinity, she decided that she must have talked about him so much that the universe connived to bring a twist into her life.
"The interesting part is that I know where he lives. It is close to us."
Remilekun waited for Desire's eyes to enlarge. But instead, Desire, trying to control the feeling inside her which she could not recognize, said,
"Well, good to know he's close by."
"Is that all you'll say? I mean, you're always talking about this man." Desire smiled. "In fact, if you weren't always talking about him, I wouldn't have known of him," Remilekun said. You that was enjoying your mother's bosom and always got what you wanted, how would you know anyone? For me, Prof is my hero. He saved me. This university education I have today is because of him."
"I won't accept that one. Your present education is because of my mother. Isn't she paying your fees and even giving you pocket money?"
Remilekun laughed and hit her playfully on her arm. "Stop. You know what I mean. It is the motivation," she raised her voice. "Okay, seriously, I don't understand you. Here is a man you saw as a child. How is he a motivation?"
"He gave his life for this country."
"What life? Did he give Nigeria her independence?" Desire realized the argument was going nowhere and instead was making them both angry. She lay back on the bed and closed her eyes, signaling the end of the conversation. "Now that your prof is close by, perhaps you will sleep better." Remilekun moved over to her side of the room and flopped onto her bed. Over the following weeks, Desire pretended she did not care about the news, but memories of Prof's visit to Maroko bothered her. She wanted to know if he had changed from what she remembered. She began to wake up each morning from dreams of Prof asking her to come for a visit, telling her how she had abandoned him. One day she returned from the campus and grabbed Remilekun's arm as she entered the room.
"Do you really know where Prof lives?"
"Who is Prof?" Desire rolled her eyes. She was not in the mood for Remilekun's games.
"Why do you need to know?"
Remilekun stopped to face her. She dropped her bag from her shoulder and dissolved into laughter.
"Don't tell me you want to go and see him."
"No."
"No?"
"No.
At least someone should know if he's as crazy as they say," she said, humoring Remilekun's derangement story.
"And what if he isn't mad?"
"If people say he went mad in prison, it could be the manageable type. The neighbors say he goes out only to the local market at night and wears a cloth that covers him from head to toe. Is that not madness? What is he hiding?"
"What could he be hiding?
He was in prison. He probably just wants to be on his own. Think, rethink, you know."
"Rethink? What is he rethinking? I mean, he was in prison for 10 years. Many of his colleagues who were jailed died there. He returns and he's rethinking."
"Rethinking what?"
"I just said that.
See, I don't even know why you're so interested in him. It doesn't make any sense."
"All I want is to get an interview for the campus paper."
"Eh?"
"You make me laugh. When did you start writing for the campus news?" Desire ignored the question, letting the discussion die. But that night, she made Remilekun take her to his block. When they reached Prof's address, they stood in front of the building, Remilekun daring her to go up and knock on his door. Desire acted defiant and walked up the stairs and spent the next few minutes staring at Prof's doorstep until Remilekun, exasperated, marched away. Desire turned away from his door with a frown. She ran to catch up with Remilekun, who seemed irritated by her lack of boldness to knock on the door. The next day, Desire returned to the house. She stood in front of his door and raised her right hand to knock, but it slipped down to her side without hitting the door. After several tries, her knuckles landed on the wooden door, and she rapped it like it was a drum. And then, as if something hit her, she stopped, turned around, and rushed down the stairs and ran into the road. Chapter 3. Prof was asleep in his cell the day his mother and friend came for him. A warder had told him some days earlier that the president had freed some prisoners, but he hadn't thought he was one of them. He no longer expected freedom. He stirred as one of the new warders tapped him on his leg.
"Prof, or what do they call you? Get ready. There are people here for you."
He raised his head up from where he lay in his cell and uncurled himself into a stretch.
"Oya, come, let's go,"
the warder said, and turned around immediately to call out to someone.
"Give that one any cloth you see. Who they keep cloth for here?"
Prof followed the warder with his head bent low, his steps slow. He veiled his face with his threadbare khaki shirt, stopping when the warder dawdled to greet or reprimand a prisoner in a cell, until they reached the front desk with other warders and a few unfamiliar faces smiling at him. "Home beckons," someone said to him. He noticed the man clasped a small gadget, later identified as the new GSM phone, in his right hand. "Mr. President has freed you." Prof placed his hands behind his back and observed the ghosts before him, his visitors, Mami and Olukayode, his childhood friend, whom everyone now called Kayo because Prof had, a result of not being able to pronounce his friend's full name as a toddler. Mami and Kayo watched him and exchanged quick glances between turning to listen and respond to the warders. He could tell from their looks that they were examining the way his shoulder blade was chiseled into his flesh, burrowing a visible hollow in his neck. "Take," Kayo said. Prof did not look at his friend's face, even as he accepted the handkerchief that he passed to him. He put it in his pocket, eyes fixed on the Nokia mobile phone which Kayo clutched. He tucked his gray vest into his trousers and swapped the prison uniform he used as a veil over his head with the flower-patterned cotton shirt they gave him to change into. The sunlight was bright, and it penetrated the shirt as soon as he stepped outside. He winced every time he needed to raise his face to the light. As he walked out of the prison, he noticed a calendar with the picture of a young girl smiling with her eyes shut. She reminded him of Desonya, who had often visited him in prison. He was going to turn away when he noticed it was a calendar from 1995, and it displayed the month of October, a month and year he could never forget. His eyes landed on the date he had come to prison, 3rd October, 1995. It was 2 days after Nigeria's independence celebration and 4 days before his 45th birthday. He thought back to that day. He was trying to avoid the cars swerving towards pedestrians who filed down the broken sidewalk of Bode Thomas Street when a man in an army green t-shirt and khaki shorts gave him a scissor kick that saw him kissing the ground. Before he could gather himself to stand, he counted 7 men, all wearing the same clothes, bent over him. They punched and kicked his ribs until he spiraled onto the ground like a millipede. In that moment, he understood what it was like to be a ball being rammed about by tennis players, as one of the men asked him, "Who hit you? Guess." The sun's rays boiled the blood and sweat dripping from his flesh, split open by the strike of cowhide whips. He raised his swollen, bloodied eyes and caught a name graffitied on a wall in white. MKO. Moshood Kashimawo Olawale Abiola, the billionaire businessman who was in prison for treason because he had declared himself president 4 months after his victory was annulled by the government. He considered that they might soon share a prison cell. The white letters of the politician's initials faded slowly to a light gray, blue-gray, then charcoal, until everything became so black he felt outside of himself. He stopped struggling against the men and watched his motionless body as he could no longer resist the darkness that possessed him, until he woke up handcuffed with a hood over his head in a vehicle that smelt of dried feces and what he would later identify as dried blood. This was how Prof. Eniolorunda was to become disconnected from the world he fought for 10 years. Prof placed his hand on Kayo's shoulder. "Take me home. I want to go to my father's house." Prof dug into his pockets for a handkerchief as his mother excavated a phone from her bag. She punched the keyboard for light and explored the walls for the switch. Prof placed the handkerchief loosely over his eyes, as a blindfold, to avoid the light of the 30-watt amber bulb which came on as he stepped into the house. The cloth covered his left eye, but the right eye, which was left partially bare, made him squint. He turned towards the curtain and felt the coarse settling of dust on the thin lines of the fabric's weave. The dust rose into his nostrils and he sneezed. His mother moved closer and slowly stroked his back. Prof did not turn to face her. He listened to her low voice as she spoke.
Kayo walked in after him and sank into a chair. Prof walked towards the farthest corner of the room, observing his mother and Kayo.
"I'm still wondering why you choose to come to your father's house and not mine," Mami sighed, before adding,
"I would have washed the window blinds or changed them for one with a brighter color, Shugbo." She rubbed her temples and looked out of the window before moving restlessly around the room.
Prof moved to take her place at the window. His eyes roamed over the row of houses with peeling paint, stopping at the faded signpost with LSDPC Low-Cost Housing Estate, Abesson, painted on it. However, everyone called the estate Jakonde Estate, after Latif Jakonde, a former governor of Lagos State who built it and many others around the city to tackle the city's housing problems. Years after, not much changed. The blocks of flats remained as ugly as he remembered. Only now, there were more discordant noises leaping from generators and pepper-grinding machines competing for attention. He rearranged the curtains, turned away from the view, and found himself facing his mother.
"The curtains are really dirty. Are you sure you don't want to stay with me, in my house?"
His mother waited for him to reply, and when he didn't, she added,
"At least for some months you can live with me. I'll cook good food. I can also bring people to clean this house and air it as well if you want to return."
He stayed quiet, her words disappearing into the air as if she never spoke.
"Kayo knows the right people if you need a job," she added. "You know how it is. Big, big women and big, big men are everywhere in this country."
Prof held Kayo in his stare for a long time. No smile, no attempt to show appreciation for the kindness spoken about. Kayo, on his part, grunted.
"You needed to remind them of me?" Prof asked.
"Habba! Your man are the people now, don't you know? We can also turn on the radio. I'm sure it's in the news."
Kayo turned around to switch on the radio on the stool beside the chair.
"Mr. President released 10 prisoners, but you are the most significant one. You're probably the headline."
"Don't put it on. It isn't necessary," Prof growled, staring down at his feet as the crackle of the radio filled the room. "Please turn it off."
Kayo waffled, but turned off the radio. Prof turned to look at his mother, studying the lines which had formed on her forehead, the corners of her eyes and the sides of her mouth. He imagined tracing them with his hand. Oblivious to the turn of his thoughts, Mami attempted to court him with stories that started off with, "Do you remember when..." He wondered if what he saw in her eyes was fear, although he couldn't say what for. He began to hum a birthday song he had heard on the car radio. She stopped talking. Kayo chuckled. "Do you miss celebrating your birthdays?" He moved closer, their shoulders brushing, and whispered, "Remember how I used to get you drunk the night before your birthday?" He hawed.
"I beg, let's see your face. Remove the shirt over your head now. Abi, you're now Captain Hook."
Kayo slapped his back and neighed. "Do you want me to get you a generator? The power situation is still terrible, though."
"How regular are the outages?"
"Ah, I can't say it is regular, as we don't even have a pattern. There's been no light here for 4 months. Even though there was a name change, the problem persists."
"What name change?"
"Oh, they changed the name from NEPA to PHCN. Power Holding Company of Nigeria, when the government privatized electricity distribution."
"We've seen no benefit so far. In fact, it is worse. We have gone from never expect power always to problem has changed name."
He sighed, and with an added intensity to this voice said, "We have not had light for 2 years now in my area. They carried our transformer away, and 3 months ago some people stole the cables. We use the generator morning and night."
"Well, it is the way it is. This is our life. We've accepted it."
Kayo laughed. "But there's regular electricity here. At least you can do some things with power. You get 4 hours out of 24 hours. It's not that bad."
"Really? How could anyone tolerate light, which brought even more darkness?" Prof asked.
He adjusted the cloth from his face to shade the light a little, before walking towards the bedroom. As he moved away, he overheard his mother saying,
"It will take a while, but we'll try to bring him back to proper life.
Prof moved down the passage into the bedroom, more certain than ever that he would keep the light out of his new home.
"You can't exist here. You should ask them to take you back to prison. I mean, that's home now, for you, for us. Think, man, think. How can prison be home? He should stay here. This is where he belongs."
"What is this one saying? Home is where your body settles even in the dark. The prison is home. Is this one okay? Was his body ever settled in prison, lest being settled in darkness? Please, Prof, don't mind him. Take your time and relax. You can make up your mind later. Seriously, when did prison become homely?"
Prof felt the voices in his head increasing as each one tried to be heard. They wanted to drown out Desonya's voice, which was usually the loudest, and the one he ended up listening to. He focused on her voice. "Nothing has changed since you went to prison. Okay, they're now GSM phones," Desonya said with a giggle.
The moment her voice came in clearly, he knew the other voices would go away and leave Desonya to speak to him. This was their routine.
"Hey, how are you coping with the new attention?"
He smiled and didn't respond. It was always how they started their conversations. She did most of the talking, and he listened.
"I see you are considering turning off the lights."
He remained silent.
"Here's something for you to ponder. Someone I loved once gave me a box full of darkness. It took me years to understand that this too was a gift."
"That's profound," he murmured, turning around to see if his mother or Kayo were behind him.
"Yes, that's Mary Oliver. Remember her?"
"Not sure I do."
"You read her to me when some Canadian NGO visited the prison with books."
"Oh, did I?" He pondered over the words. Desonya had come to him as a gift. When he had been thrown into solitary confinement, the many voices in his head wouldn't stop talking. He would press his hands to his ears and scream, but that did not stop them. Until Desonya came to him. She whispered,
"Breathe, breathe, breathe."
He listened to her, and the other voices left. She stayed. Desonya was different. She didn't have a name when she came to him. He just thought of her as the voice. He wanted to give Desonya a personality, so he started with a name. A name from a memory that would not go away. He gave the voice the name of a little girl in Maroko, an area for low and middle income earners who bragged to be homeowners even though they waded through potholes to arrive to a house sinking in the mire. The location appealed to the country's big men, and the people of Maroko were given an eviction notice over the radio and asked to vacate the area by the following day. Prof was in a caucus meeting of activists when he heard the story, and he hurried over to the area. As he spoke to the thousands of eyes staring at him, hopeful that something could change, his gaze landed on this little girl with eyes like water in a glass. He picked her up from the ground and carried her in his arms. The feeling he felt holding her was close to nothing he could compare, except to once in life when he felt he was going to eventually be a father. It was just a moment, one he tried not to think of. Yet, as he looked into the little girl's eyes, he felt as if cold water was running down his entire body and he shivered. A strange feeling overcame him. He felt a sudden yearning, which was not for want of a daughter. Rather, she made him want to become a little girl. He wanted to feel vulnerable and be so innocent he could share his emotion without fear of judgment. He asked for her name. She whispered into his ear like someone blowing off a candle in three breaths, and he heard, "Desonya." He left Maroko with her presence still filling the corner of his arm where she had rested when he carried her, filling a place that had become empty at a point in his life. Many weeks later, with his heart buried in a vacuum, he returned to look for her, and someone told him that a pillar had fallen on her and killed her. He left the place emptier than when he came. "You've lost another one," he told himself. The name Desonya suited the voice. It filled up the emptiness that came with the loss with warmth. While he could not see this new Desonya, he could always spread his arms along the prison wall, begging Desonya to come for a chat. There were times she did not come. Those times, he
he cried as he pined for her. Those times, he felt lucky to sight an aunt in the cell that he could talk to and express how much he missed Desonya. He would jump with hysterical happiness and then smile at his luck when an aunt waited for a few minutes to listen to him whine. At other times, when he was overcome with weakness, he would strain his ears to listen to the echoes of laughter, groans, or deep sighs from the other cells. Desonya interrupted him, and he stirred from his thoughts.
You should go to your mother and Kayo. You're spending too much time alone.
Chapter 4 Mami and Kayo startled as Prof hurried out of the bedroom. They stopped talking. Prof, ignoring them, began pacing the length and breadth of the sitting room, counting his steps and measuring the distance between the kitchen, the bedroom, and the bathroom, and the spaces between the furniture and the walls loudly. He closed his eyes as he did this, until he felt he was familiar with the spaces around the house, and then he returned to the side of the sitting room, where Mami and Kayo were now talking in low tones. When he turned to face them, he observed how Kayo and Mami, now quiet, conversed with their eyes, their throats bopping up and down as they swallowed spittle. Kayo's heavy breathing and Mami's quiet humming sounded like background music to an anticipated act. Prof watched his friend's traveling eyes, which moved about as if trying to leap out of the sockets, and ascertained that his friend kept something from him. Many things from him. Theirs was a friendship that was almost natal and bore many good stories of the past. In their childhood, they were like conjoined twins. Seeing one meant the other was close. Prof was the one who had sense, while Kayo was the one whose head was not correct. The community threw this readily at Kayo, for it was common knowledge that his coarse voice was because of the guana he smoked openly from the age of 9. Kayo never hid behind uncompleted fences or deserted schools like the other children who smoked marijuana. He went about smoking it openly like a cigarette, which itself was seen as bad enough for teenagers. Kayo would take a puff and roll the whiff of cannabis in his mouth until it gathered into fumes that formed mushroom clouds, which he blew into the faces of the children that gathered around him, while their mothers cursed from a distance, taking care not to come near him. They feared Kayo for his unpredictability. Yet Prof knew he was timid, that his actions were a cover-up for his many fears. He could not confront anyone who stood up to him. Those who were not hassled by his upfront hard ways, which were actually a way to distract others from his diffidence. Prof saw himself and Kayo run into the stream to watch naked girls take their bath, plucking fruits from neighbors' trees and running errands for older people for a fee. There were also the distinct stories of selflessness and sacrifice. One time, Prof stole books from the office of the headmaster of the only secondary school in Ilese, and Kayo, who accompanied him, was the one who was caught. Rather than relaying the story of how his friend lacked books but loved to read so much and that he had accompanied him to steal the books, he let out the first words which must have made sense to him in the convenience of defending a crime he knew he could not disentangle himself from. He looked up at the guard who caught him and said, "I just finished shitting, sir. The paper was for my yash." He placed his hands over his buttocks to emphasize the purpose and place of the paper. Later, on the assembly ground, in front of the other students, he screamed, "The paper was for my yash, sir," into the air, but not once did he mention his friend's name. Many years later, unsure of what to do with their lives in the village after they completed university, they both moved to Lagos, and their struggles were soon forgotten, with regular visits to Abeigi, the open food and beer joint, where journalists, artists, activists, writers, and poets gathered under the leafy cover of almond trees at the National Theater. They spent hour after hour there with other comrades and artists, talking arts, politics, and imagining sex until alcohol turned people into grouches, cursing even their beer bottles, or simply laughing into the air with their fantasies. As he stood facing Kayo in a room, years after they felt they could have died for each other, he wondered if their younger selves might have screamed in disbelief at the way their eyes now tore into each other as they considered the possible consequences that could result from the other's defiance. He walked past Kayo and his mother and walked towards the switch for the light,
then flicked it. Prof ignored Kayo's curses at the power outage, straining to study the outline of his mother and friend in the shadows. He let the fatigued silhouettes swallow as much silence as they could before saying in a quiet voice, "I turned off the lights." Adjusting the cloth over his eyes, he moved towards the curtains and adjusted them to give the room an even darker shade. He waited, expecting Mami or Kayo to make a comment. When none was offered, he added, "I've been thinking about lights for a while now," and he closed his eyes and then opened them again slowly into the dimness. "I don't think the light is important."
"Which one is this again? What has light got to do with your return?" Kayo asked.
He took a few steps forward, but stopped as Prof began to talk. "I'm fine. I'm just saying I'll be staying in the dark now," Prof replied with his eyes closed. There was a sound, and Prof could not make out if it was a chuckle or a throat being cleared. He also could not tell from whom it came.
"You want to live in the dark?" Kayo said.
It was a statement meant as a question, and he did not respond to it.
"So, how long are you going to live in the dark? Mr. Man, you're funny, Sha. Electricity is never regular anyway, so what's with the drama?"
Kayo stomped towards the switch, laughing. His voice juddered with the laughter until it reached a truck horn pitch. Don't do it," Prof said, making sure his tone conveyed both his annoyance and desire. He waited, half hoping Kayo would be defiant and challenge him. Kayo walked 3 steps towards him, then stopped.
"This is not funny. And what would you do if I switched on the lights?"
"I can't tell," he replied in a whisper.
"Why are you doing this? May we not live in dark times, man?"
Kayo said, turning the situation into a prayer, as was typical of the Yoruba. His voice was as low as Prof's, who was listening for footsteps, so he could tell when his friend moved towards the switch.
He sensed that there was something different.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.